What is going on, everyone? Darkside Phil here with some nicely, freshly washed, luxurious hair for you. This is what happens when I wash it and I don't put any product or anything in it. It just gets poofy like this. But anyway, welcome to another edition of the Hateful Truth video game review series, where I give you maximum truth and minimum bullshit regarding a game that I have played here on my YouTube channel, DSPGaming, and I don't cater to any of these mainstream media companies. I don't answer to anyone. I'm not employed by anyone. I'm an independent, and therefore I can give you my honest thoughts on games that I play. And today we're going to talk about a game. It's a little bit unique. It does a couple things in an interesting way, and I think that, unfortunately, what I've seen, at least in the mainstream media who have reviewed this game, there seems to be a dichotomy, because a lot of people seem to have not really played that far into the game. At least you could tell it from their reviews. And we'll talk a little bit about that. But I really feel that when you invest enough time in the game, it's actually a pretty worthwhile game. And one of the best action-based RPGs that I've played in the past couple of years. What I'm actually talking about is Capcom's Dragon's Dogma. Okay? And this review is a little bit in the making. It took a little bit longer than usual to make, simply because I was busy with a lot of stuff, travel and such. So now it's been a couple weeks since I've beaten it, and I'm finally getting a chance to review the game. So Dragon's Dogma, what is it at its core? It is an action-based RPG. Some people would call it a JRPG. I think some people would argue and say, no, it's really not in the style of a JRPG. It's very action-oriented. It's not turn-based like other RPGs, and it is open world, meaning you will have, at the beginning of the game, the ability to explore the majority of the map of the game. However, the game does not actually scale, per se, with you. And what that means is that you will wander into areas that, unfortunately, there will be very high-level creatures that will just, very simply put, kick your ass. We're going to talk a little bit about the balancing and the leveling and a lot of the things involved in this game. And the way that I approached it, because being that I knew this was an RPG and the fact that it was action-based, I knew there was going to be a lot of grinding involved, which I did do, and I feel that's why I was able to complete the playthrough and get a better picture of how the game actually plays. So that being said, let's talk a little bit about the game and the plot. The plot is you create your own character. It could be male or female. And this character, at the beginning of the game, is living in a village, perfectly, you know, happy with its own life. And all of a sudden, the village gets attacked by a dragon, okay? This giant red dragon attacks the village. You take up arms to try to defend the village. The dragon ends up talking to you somehow and actually ripping your heart out of your chest and keeping your heart for itself, yet somehow you survive. From this point on in the game, you actually begin to be called Dragonborn. And there is this legend that people who are Dragonborn have special powers. They can talk to dragons. Maybe they have the ability to stop dragons. And so the plot of the game is that this dragon is going all around the land, destroying things and basically wreaking havoc. There's even a prophecy that the coming of the dragon could be the end of the world. And it's your goal to traverse through this world, go to the main city called Grand Sorin, speak with the Duke about what's going on, and figure out how you can help, whether you're going to fight the dragon or maybe there's other quests that you can do on your course to eventually fighting the dragon at the end of the game. And so right from the get-go, you get tossed into this action-based world with a lot of side quests and a lot of things that are optional, which is pretty neat. So right off the bat, when you start the game, you get what's called a pawn, okay? A pawn is a unique premise, at least, the way that it's used in this game. Most games, RPGs, you have a team of people who you're working with. In some games, you can control them, in some games, you can't. In this game, what they call pawns are these AI-controlled characters, which when you actually create one at the beginning of the game, you can kind of morph who you want it to be, whether you want it to be a mage or a warrior class, whether you want it to be more aggressive, or maybe focus more on supporting you and healing you. You have the ability right at the beginning of the game. Now, this pawn that you create is going to be your main pawn for the entire game, meaning it'll always be with you, unless they just happen to, you know, die, okay? In addition to that, later on in the game, you actually get the ability to summon more pawns. Now, the way the game works is you gain experience in combat and also for completing quests, and you level up, and so does your pawn. Now, you actually have the ability to pick and choose your special techniques. So if you're a warrior, maybe you're picking some combat abilities. If you're a strider or a ranger, maybe you're picking arrow abilities. If you're a mage, maybe you're picking magical abilities, etc. And then also for your pawn, your main pawn, you get to also do that, pick what abilities they have. For the other two pawns that you summon, you do not have that ability. Basically, you summon them, and when you do, they're stuck at a certain level. So if you summon them and they're level 10, they will always be level 10. They will not level up. You will not have the ability to customize anything with them. And because of that, what you're going to find yourself doing is during the course of the game, maybe you'll play, oh, I'm level 10 now. You have some level 10 pawns with you, but then when you get to level 15, these guys are too weak. And you'll go back and you'll summon new pawns to replace them. The way the pawn system works is that the ones that you summon to join your team are actually other people's created pawns. That's right, other people who create their main pawn who stays with them for the whole game. These pawns actually go online and you're able to access them, which is a really unique and neat feature. And what ends up happening is, yeah, you use other people's pawns and you rate them when you get rid of them, or when, you know, when they die, you can all, you know, that unfortunately sometimes they die, you just have to go get new pawns. And based off of the rating and the length of time that you use them, they actually gain unique knowledge and abilities. So let's say, for example, I'm playing the game for 5 hours today and I turn it off. Well, tomorrow when I turn it on, if I go to the area where my pawn is, which is any inn basically, you basically can see what your pawn's been doing, who's been using them in their own games. And based off of that, you get what's called Rift Crystals as a reward, as well as items and loot that people choose to give you for basically a reward for using your pawn. And it could be a really weird slippery slope here, because I tell you right now, because I'm on YouTube, because I do playthroughs of all the games that I play, so many people saw that my pawn was there and they wanted to use her, that they used her in their games, and I got a ridiculous amount of loot and rift crystals just from this pawn system. So even without even doing anything in the game, I got some of the best loot in the game. I got a ridiculous amount of rift crystals, which actually allowed me to buy a much higher level pawn to join my party than my party was. So I was like level 15, 20, and I was hiring level 50 pawns, and they were going out there and kicking ass. And this obviously gave me kind of an unfair advantage against a lot of the enemies in the game, but that's a unique system in the game. The average person is not going to be able to be getting hundreds of thousands of these rift crystals and summoning the most powerful pawns in the game, and therefore they're going to have a harder time with the game than I had, I'm sure. Now, what ends up happening when the game starts is it's you and your pawn, and you walk off to a fort, and then during that time, you fight some giant monsters, okay? You're going to fight a Hydra, you're going to end up running into so many different things, a Chimera, Griffins, Drakes, which are kind of miniature versions of dragons, Ogres, Trolls, Cyclopses, they're all in this game. They're large-scale, mini-boss-style monsters, and for normal combat, depending on what class you picked, you know, you're going to have melee attacks, you're going to have magical attacks if you're a mage, you're going to have arrow attacks if you're a strider, and so really your class is going to be based off of what you chose to do when you created your character. Now later on in the game, you have the ability to pick other classes and switch classes, so you're not permanently stuck in what you start as. If you end up not liking it, you know, further into the game, you can switch over to a drastically different class, which is a good thing in my opinion, especially if you're in the long haul for this game and you're going to do a lot of gameplay and grinding, you might want to try out all the classes, okay? So, during combat, you're going to be using these action-based abilities. Now, they have cooldown. Just like in any RPG, you're going to use a spell, you can't immediately use the spell again. You might have a cooldown period before you can use it again. Similarly, with the arrows and such, you have a stamina meter. And once your stamina meter runs out, that's it. You have to wait for it to recharge before you can use another special action. So you're going to be careful during your gameplay that you manipulate your stamina, your magic meters properly, that you're not constantly running out of these abilities, because that's going to really screw you up in combat. Another thing you have to be really careful of is the inventory system. And this is one of my complaints about these games. RPGs are so intent on enforcing an inventory system that has limited space and limited weight. Like, it has to be hyper-fucking-realistic. I have a question. What on earth does it add to a game to say that this has weight, and because you have a heavy amount of loot on you that, you know, you can't walk as fast or you have lower stamina? Like, that doesn't add anything to the gameplay. That just fucking annoys the gamer. And it just creates needless micromanagement of your inventory constantly. Gee, do I have too much? Oh, let me give it to this pawn so that I'm not as heavy. Oh, when I go back to the inn, I better drop off half my inventory into this chest because I might be too heavy. And it's so fucking annoying. I don't understand why these games are doing it. Now, Maybe say, oh, the game's too easy if you have unlimited inventory. Well, then just make other things more difficult. I would rather have a more challenging combat and boss fight than worry about my fucking inventory for so much. And unfortunately, that ended up being one of my major negatives with the game. You're constantly worried about your fucking inventory and the weight of your inventory because you don't want to be over-encumbered and end up being too heavy and have low stamina. Really annoying, okay? That being said, during combat, outside of just doing your normal attacks and your abilities that you level up with as you progress in the game, you also have the ability to grab and to climb. And what I mean by that is if there's a smaller enemy, you can grab them and hold them and maybe have them, you know, held, you can't move, and one of your pawns will come up and smack them and kill them, okay? But when you're fighting these larger scale monsters like a cyclops or a troll, these things are huge, and to get to their weak points, which may be their face or their eye, you need to climb on them. So you can actually jump and climb on these monsters and start whacking at their heads. And the amount of time that you can stay on them depends on your stamina and if it runs out, and also depends on the monster itself. Some monsters, for example, the griffin will start to fly and might throw you off of it. Or the troll might reach back and grab you and throw you off of them. And you gotta be very careful because there are some monsters that will jump on their backs or they'll try to get rid of you and you get hurt during this, okay? Just like other RPGs, there's gonna be potions for healing. The mage class can actually heal you with healing magic. So it's pretty standard fare. It's very action-based, like I said. One of the other negatives that I have to say about the game is that you really can't control your pawns. What I mean is you cannot take control of them, you cannot order them to do anything. All you can really do is at the beginning of the game when you create your main pawn, you can try to give its behavior certain traits, and then there's actually something called a knowledge chair, which you sit down with your pawn, you talk to it, and you tell it whether or not you want it to do certain actions in combat, whether or not you want it to talk as much as it does, because the pawns do openly talk during the gameplay. And so you can actually change the behavior of your main pawn right then. But for your other two pawns, which you summon, you cannot ever change their behavior. So you might end up with a level 50 warrior, and he's an idiot, and he doesn't fucking attack properly, or, you know, differently from that. Maybe he's too aggressive, and he runs off and starts fights before you're ready. That could be a major problem with the game, and it is a little bit annoying that you can't really control those pawns. And so really, the gameplay can be hit or miss depending on when you're doing these larger scale fights. You may end up in a really risky one, and for some reason your sorcerer just never will cast their powerful spell, and so the fight takes forever, as opposed to if you would just fucking cast it, you'd probably kill the monster pretty quickly. And it is a little bit confusing in that regard. Outside of just the combat, you've also got these open world optional quests, meaning you might be, go over here and grab this item for me. Catch this thief in town who's been stealing stuff at night. Escort this person from point A to point B on the world map and make sure that they survive. So you're going to have these quests, and they're completely optional, but they actually, if you complete them, open up other quests that will branch out later on in the game, and it can actually affect the gameplay. So for example, there's a quest to find a magical book for some guy in town. And if you choose to do it and you give him the book, later on in the game during a difficult boss battle, this guy shows up out of the blue and uses the book to cast a magic spell on the boss that grounds it and makes the boss fight significantly easier. Now, you could have not done that optional mission. It would have been a much harder boss fight. Similarly to that, there's some of the escort missions end up leading off to branching paths and end up really opening up a bunch of side missions later on. So it's worth it if you're taking your time with this game to do all the side missions for the experience, for the money you're going to get paid, and for the sake of opening up other optional missions. Now, if you don't want to do that, you can just cruise straight through the main quest of the game. It would probably take you about 10 to 12 hours, I would say, just to beat the main quest, if you're just turboing through it and you really don't care about any of the optional content. But it really is the optional content where this game shines. And what I mean by that is when I was playing this game, the way that I approached it was every day I would play maybe 5 hours of gameplay of the story and I would record it, but then at night I would grind. I would take my pawns out into the open world, we would explore the world map, we would go to all these optional areas and fight these monsters. And it would be just a lot of grinding, fighting bandits and goblins and such, but also we would find the locations of the monsters that respawn that are the bigger boss fights. So the giant rock monsters, there's two of them on the world map you can repeatedly fight once a day. The trolls, the cyclopses, the chimeras, all these, I learned how to fight them really easily, and they give you giant experience when you actually kill them. So it's worth it to repetitively go around the world fighting these monsters. And just to say, hey, it's fucking cool to fight these giant monster battles, scaling the monster, whacking a snake head with your sword so you chop it off, and then you jump down, you have your mages casting magic on it, and you're fucking attacking it from all angles. It's a lot of fun. And the monsters do have certain archetypes. Like, there's an archetype of more of a crawling monster. There's a flying monster archetype. And then there's, like, the troll humanoid monster archetype. There's three main ones in the game. And they are, like, for example, the Cyclops is kind of similar to the troll. Who's kind of similar to the ogre. They're not so much different. Similarly to that, the griffin is kind of similar to the drake that you fight, only the drake is much more powerful. So there are a lot of similarities with these fights, but they are kind of unique. Now, one feature that I really enjoyed in this game is it actually connects to social media, meaning you can log into your Facebook account through your console, and as you're fighting one of these awesome fights, you can actually take a screenshot and upload it to your Facebook account. So while I was grinding, even though the combat was repetitive and people probably wouldn't have wanted to see it, I was able to upload these pictures of these awesome boss fights to my Facebook account, and people were pleased. They were like, wow, this is really neat. It feels like we're kind of still experiencing the grinding, and you're getting to see some of the awesome boss fights. Or not boss fights, but the awesome monster fights during the game. So, what are some of the interesting things I liked about the game, and what are some of the things that I didn't like about the game? Well, I definitely enjoyed the combat. I think that once you get used to it, once you grind a bit, you're able to enjoy the combat a lot more. I like the fact that it's an open-world game, and you can explore, and there's all these different locales, from beaches, to high-up plateaus, to canyons, to just grassy plains, to mountains. There's a lot of different locations in the game that you can explore, and it really will take you a significant chunk of hours just to explore the entire world map, okay? Now, some of these places are completely optional. Some of them will require you to go back to them. One thing that is important to say, there is no fast travel, per se, in this game. What you end up finding or purchasing during the game, I forget if they were called Fairstones. They're stones that teleport you back to the capital, which is the main hub of the game. Now, later on in the game, you end up finding these crystals after certain boss fights. And these crystals you can place on the world map wherever you feel is appropriate. And you can use the waystones or the far... I apologize, I can't remember what they're called. But you can use the stones to teleport to those points as well. So as you play the game and you progress, yes, there is actually fast travel. But it is a little bit on the annoying side that most of the game you have to be walking from point A to point B to figure out what's going on. So where the game shines is the combat and the fact that it's completely open world, the graphics are gorgeous, the enemies are varied and interesting. In that respect, it feels like an interactive living world. Unfortunately, there are some negatives. I apologize because I was waiting for a text. Okay. As I played the game, some of the things I really didn't like about the game I want to kind of focus on right now. At the beginning of the game, some of the enemies are not completely fairly scaled. And what I mean is, when I really set out from the first town, rather than go right to the next story mission, I wanted to kind of explore a little bit. And as I did, I ran into this group of bandits. And all the bandits were pretty much my level. I was able to beat them fairly, you know, within reason. And then all of a sudden, one of them runs up with a shield and a sword, and he's fucking insanely powerful. He can kill my entire party with one hit. He's going like, boom, up, you're dead. Boom, oh, you're dead. And in addition to that, he didn't even, like, react when we hit him. He had an amazing amount of health, and as we were hitting him with arrows, with magic, he's like, ha-ha, fuck you, I'm Superman, or the Terminator, or some shit. And he was just tearing through us. And it makes no sense. Why do you have a mob of bandits that are your level, and all of a sudden in the middle there's a guy that's, like, ridiculously powerful? And it wasn't, like, just that mob. It seemed like every mob of bandits that I came to in the game, there was one guy with a sword and shield who was fucking super powerful, and didn't make sense, didn't scale properly. In that regard. Now, like I said, the enemies do not scale, but it's annoying that you would have one guy who's so much stronger than the rest of the guys in his party. And even later on in the game, that seemed to happen. I would fight mobs where there's one monster way stronger than all the others, and you have to try to pick off all the others and then have everyone focus on this one person, which is kind of annoying. And outside of that, I do have to say, like I said, the fact that there's no fast travel at the beginning of the game is kind of annoying. I do have to say, the story of the game is interesting, but it's annoying the way that they lay it out, meaning the majority of the chunks of the story of the game actually come at the end of the game. There's actually like a final boss fight, and then a little twist, and the game continues going on for several hours, and you finally get more tidbits of the story, and you start to understand what's going on. But you have to play most of the game up to that point to even get to that story tidbit. And so you may be wondering, gee, the story's really sparse here. They're not really explaining anything. I don't understand, who is this dragon? How am I alive with my heart ripped out? This makes no sense. You won't understand any of that till the end of the game. And a lot of people are kind of saying this game is the flip side of Mass Effect 3. I mean, Mass Effect 3 had amazing story throughout, and then the ending sucked. In this game, it's like the story's very sparse throughout, and the ending's really fucking interesting and good, but you have to play through the whole game to get to it. And the question is, if you don't like the grinding-style gameplay of the game, and you don't like the combat, you're probably not going to get to it. Who's going to invest, you know, 10, 20, 30 hours of gameplay to get to the end of the game to finally get that reward? I mean, where was that during the game? There is some story, but nothing's clear. It's very confusing as to what exactly is going on. There's some kind of a plot line regarding other people who are Dragonborn like you, and trying to figure out who they really are, and finding out whether you really need to fight the dragon, or maybe you can strike a deal with it, finding out that other people in the game are actually pawns who you thought were normal humans, they're pawns in the game. A really weird abstract story until the end, and then everything's explained. I don't want to spoil it for anyone who didn't play the game, that's the thing. So I don't want to explain to you what happens at the end of the game, but it's really fucking good. There's a good 3 to 4 hours of amazing gameplay at the end of the game, because here's what happens. There's a final boss fight, and then depending on what choice you made during the boss fight, the game could either end or continue. If the game continues, a completely new and amazing dungeon opens up. This dungeon has some bosses that you've never fought in the game before, including giant eyeball monsters, really high-level normal monsters, but they're like unique, stronger versions of the normal monsters you fought in the game. There's another dragon in there that's a super powerful dragon that takes a long-ass time to kill. There's another drake in there. There's all these new monsters that you get to fight. And it's like, wow, I played a billion hours. Now all of a sudden there's all this new content. Where the hell was this during the course of the game? And it is kind of annoying in that regard that they kind of save all that for the end game. And I think a lot of people, if they knew that that was coming, they maybe would have played the game more and put up with it. And this leads me into what I want to talk about with the mainstream media when they reviewed this game, okay? I can tell you for a fact, right now, that at least 2 gaming magazines that I read that reviewed Dragon's Dogma, the person who reviewed it didn't beat the game, never got to the ending and got to that content. Because when you read the review, the things they say are things that you would basically be able to write within the first couple hours. The thing that I just mentioned, sometimes there's an enemy that's way more powerful than the rest of the mob, okay? In addition to that, the fact that there's no fast travel at the beginning of the game. This is all they mention. They never mention the ending of the game, the amazing amount of story that comes at the end of the game, the great several hours at the end of the game of gameplay, the challenging boss fight. They never even talked about it. And because they probably never fucking got to it. And that's just irresponsible journalism. And so when I read a magazine that gives this game a fucking 6, but the guy obviously never beat the game and didn't get to the best part of the game, which is the last, say, 5 hours of the game is amazing gameplay, then, you know what? Fuck you. You've basically not only misrepresented the game, you've misrepresented yourself as a journalist because you haven't given the game a fair shake. So I have to say that. I'm very disappointed with the mainstream reviews that I've been reading in magazines because I could tell that they didn't beat the game. If they did, they would have definitely mentioned, wow, there's all these crazy or unique monster fights and bosses at the end of the game. The story picks it up a notch, and it's, so I could understand if they said, well, that's too little too late. They don't even mention it, okay? So it's bullshit. So what I want to say is, if you're the kind of person who likes action-based RPGs and you don't mind grinding gameplay, you want to play this game at a more relaxed pace, this is the game for you. You're going to like the fact that you can have unique abilities, you're leveling up, you can pick pawns that are constantly different, and you get items overnight when you're not playing. You even get rewarded for creating a good pawn that other people use. The open world is amazing. Leveling up to the point where you can actually go through the world and kill these larger, unique monsters fairly easily is really fun. Actually fighting the drake for the first time kicks ass. It's really hard to kill. When you finally kill it, you're like, yes, I fucking got it. And it's just feeling of accomplishment when you go through the game and you do a lot of the stuff in the game. So it's a lot of fun, and it's definitely worth it if you put the time into it. If you're not the kind of person who wants to sink a significant amount of time into a game like this, this is not going to be your kind of game. You're going to find it boring. You're going to say there's not enough story. The combat's repetitive. Yada, yada, yada. This is a game that you have to understand that the grinding is part of the gameplay, and the grinding is fun. And for a playthrough, for me to record the grinding, probably not fun to watch, but it is fun to experience. And so I'm going to give the game an overall score. remember that my rating system is a lot more strict than everyone else's, okay? And when I rate the games on a 10 scale, if I give it a 5, it's completely average. It's right down the middle. It's not a bad game, it's just average. So after considering all the factors, the flaws with the game, but also some of the amazing stuff that happens if you understand what the game is, and you put the significant amount of time to get to those last several hours of amazing gameplay at the end of the game, I'm going to give Dragon's Dogma a 7.75. That's right. Almost great. If I give it like an 8, I probably would have said it's a great game. I think it's a really well done game. It was a well thought out game. But the fact that the story is so sparse until the last couple hours, and the fact that there are some startling issues at the beginning of the game, like I said, the enemies that aren't scaled with the rest of the mob that they're in, the fact that you have to constantly be walking, there's no fast travel until later in the game, is really annoying, and those things can add up to the fact that a lot of people probably just won't ever beat the game because they don't want to put up with these annoyances. But if you take your time and you enjoy grinding like I do, when I played this game, my attitude was play it during the day and then just relax here on the couch and I have a drink. You know, Matt, go through. I was watching movies on my computer, on my Blu-ray drive on my computer while I was playing, you know? And so it's not something to be taken super seriously, but you can relax and chill out while you're doing it, and you're leveling up and you're gaining stuff. And then, hey, you can share it through social media, which is a nice feature as well. So, overall, Dragon's Dogma, I think it was well executed, but you have to be a patient gamer in order to get to the meat of the game, which is the last several hours. Unfortunately, the majority of gamers probably won't do it. Hell, half the mainstream reviewers didn't do it and reviewed the game poorly because they're fucking idiots and they just don't do their jobs responsibly. But I think the game was well done. I actually enjoyed it, and I wish that more people would give this game attention rather than just writing it off and say, oh, this guy gave it a 6, says it's boring. And he fucking throws it, you know, rather than actually understanding what the game is. If you're the kind of person that likes grinding, likes action-based gameplay, this is going to be your game. If you don't like that, and you don't ever want to grind, this is not your game. Stay away. You will not enjoy this game. This is a lot of the gameplay is based around the grinding and exploring the open world to find unique monsters, to find unique locales, and to unlock stuff. So you're not going to want to do that. If you're the kind of person that doesn't like grinding, you're not going to enjoy the game. I think the game's good. 7.75. Alright, so that's it for the Hateful Truth on Dragon's Dogma. I hope you found that it was informative. I hope I gave you maximum truth to minimum bullshit. I will see you next time for the Hateful Truth video game review series. Thanks.